সবাইকে স্বাগত জানাচ্ছি চলতে চলতে অনুষ্ঠানে। সাথে আছে আমি মাহফুজ মিশু, আর আজকে আমার অতিথি আমাদের সবার খুব প্রিয় মুখ, পরিচিত মুখ, ঢাকায় মার্কিন রাষ্ট্রদূত ড্যান মজীনা। অ্যাম্বাসেডর মজীনা, মোস্ট ওয়েলকাম টু আওয়ার শো চলতে চলতে।
হাউ আর ইউ? ভেরি মাচ। হাউ আর ইউ? আই অ্যাম গ্রেট মিশু, হাউ আর ইউ টুডে?
আই অ্যাম ফাইন। অ্যাম্বাসেডর, উই ওয়ান্ট টু নো ড্যান মজীনা, ইউ আর দ্য আমেরিকান অ্যাম্বাসেডর হিয়ার, সো ইউ আর আমেরিকান বাংলাদেশ, এভরি পিপল নোজ ইউ ভেরি মাচ, বাট ইউ we want to discover you as a person, Mojina. Obviously you have a life, you have personal life, you have your wife, you have your family, you have your son, you have your daughter, you have your dreams. We want to know it in this program. I would like to start from your childhood.
Oh, that's a great place to start. Well, I think the place to start is with the reality that I was born and raised on a dairy farm.
Yeah.
We had 120 acres, about 50 hectares, which is a tiny, tiny farm. We milked 40 cows, and we had pigs and some beef cattle. Very small place. But for the first 18 years of my life, I lived on that farm twice a day, every day, 365 days a year, I milk cows. I went to a tiny school.
Yeah.
It was built.
Only 12 students were there.
Yeah, 12 students. How do you know that? 12 students. One teacher, 12 students, and it was from kindergarten to grade 8. And that school had nothing, but that school had everything.
Everything.
We had no water, we had no toilets, we had no library, we had one set of encyclopedias. But we had a teacher of passion. Her name was Miss Albrecht. I remember her vividly. Miss Albrecht. Miss Albrecht, she had never traveled in her life. But in her mind, she had been every place in the world. And so for us, you know, we're little kids sitting like this. We don't know anything. We don't know anything. We've never been anywhere. But she's up there and she's describing all these wonderful places in the world.
She's your favorite teacher?
Yeah. Oh my goodness, yes. Miss Albrecht is everything. And my older brother, the same thing. He's a physician. And both he and I say it's only because of Miss Albrecht. And she just like opened her eyes, and she made us so curious.
She is alive?
No, she died many years ago, but I wrote her a letter. I said, Miss Albrecht, you probably don't remember me, but I'm Danny. They used to call me Danny.
Yeah.
I am Danny Mozina. I was in your first grade, third grade, and fourth grade class. I skipped second grade. And I said in that letter, you changed everything in my life. Anyway.
So after completion of school, you have started your college life and university life. We want to hear the stories from your university life.
Then I went to a wonderful school in my home state of Iowa. It's an agriculture school, but I didn't study agriculture. I studied what was then called government, and now people say political science. But I studied government and I studied history. And I don't know why. I just love those things. I don't know why.
If you don't mind, can you please tell us shortly about the story of your marriage? How could you meet madam? Or is it was an arranged marriage?
No. In America, we don't have so many arranged marriages. But my wife knew me from the time I was 11 years old.
Okay.
I knew her from the time she was 13 years old. We're exactly the same age, but I didn't know her for 2 years, but she knew who I was. And it's all through a youth organization, young people organization, called 4-H. And we were both very active. I came from the north end of the county.
And she came from?
And she came from the south end of the county. And so we were active, and so we would meet, and she knew who I was 2 years before I knew who she was. But then, you know, we met and we had many trips and we got, anyway, so we've now been married 43 years.
43 years, and you are blessing with two kids.
I have two kids. Oh, I have wonderful kids. My older child is a daughter, and she's just now, I hope this week, submitting her thesis for her master's degree. Wow. And she's a teacher.
Okay.
So maybe she's the teacher I was supposed to be. Yeah, that was my old dream. She's a teacher of English, a very, really good teacher. And she is the mother, she married a Marine, United States Marine, and they have a baby. And that baby is...
So you are a grandfather also?
I am a grandfather. One time, my granddaughter is 1 year and 2 days old. Her birthday was November 18th.
Very good connection 18th. With her.
Oh, I Skype with her every day.
What about your son?
My son is living in Washington. He went to school here in Dhaka at the American embassy, at the American school, American International School of Dhaka. He was here 3 years. He graduated from this school. And then he went to university and finished undergraduate and went, and he got a PhD, took 6 years or something. A PhD in astrophysics. So my son studies the universe.
Yeah.
Now, so he finished that last June, and now he is working in Washington, D.C. on Capitol Hill.
Capitol Hill?
Congress.
Yeah.
And he works, our parliament, so he works there at Congress as a science fellow.
Okay.
And he works with a member of Congress giving advice on science. My son loves it so much. Okay. He's so happy.
Ambassador, we have to take a short break.
Okay.
We'll just back. Darshok, chotto ekta biroti nichhi. Amader shonge thakun. Kotha bolbo Markin Rashtradut Dan Mojinar shonge. Birotir por arekbar shagoto cholto cholto onushthane. Kotha bolchhilam Ambassador Dan Mojinar shonge. Ambassador, we want to know about your career. Why you were supposed to be a teacher, and but finally you have been a diplomat? And
well, that's a great question. And actually, the answer goes back to Miss Albrecht, my teacher,
your teacher in
that one room school. So she painted these images of the world, and I never forget. One image was about the Silk Road.
About the
Silk Road. That connected China with Italy and the Europe, the Silk Road all through. So I remember this like it was yesterday. She's up there talking about the Silk Road, and I must be like 9 years old, and I'm sitting there in the little chair like this, and I'm thinking, I want to see the Silk Road someday. I want to walk on the Silk Road someday. I remember thinking those thoughts. Of course, this will never happen because we come from a farm. It's the last farm on the lane. The lane ends on our farm. No farm after us.
So you can't move.
We're the end. We're the end of the world, literally and figuratively. So, but that's where the seed was planted. That's where the curiosity was planted. Goes back to this teacher, a teacher of great passion. And that passion she put into my heart. And I wanted to learn, and I wanted to see, and I wanted to go places. And over time, that's exactly what happened. My wife and I were in this 4-H program. I went to Nepal, she went to Thailand. And then we got bitten by the bug to see the world. And then we got married, I went to graduate school, and then we went to Peace Corps, 2.5 years, lived in the middle of absolutely no place in a small village on the banks of a river, Kwilu River. And we lived there for 2.5 years working with chickens.
Chickens?
Yeah. And then we came back to America. I moved back to Iowa, my home. I moved back into my hometown. We bought a small house, and I thought we'll live here forever. 9 months later, we sold the house, moved to Washington.
Washington.
Because we didn't fit in Iowa anymore. We were citizens of the world, and citizen of the world, it didn't work.
Yeah.
It didn't work for us. And so we had to move. And we moved to Washington. And there I worked with 4-H, the same 4-H, for a couple of years, traveling all over the world. And then as I learned about the Foreign Service, then I took the test and joined the Foreign Service. So that's how I got in the Foreign Service. All goes back to Miss Albrecht. But there's a direct link to Miss Albrecht. So here's Miss Albrecht talking about the Silk Road. And I'm thinking someday I am going to walk on the Silk Road.
On the Silk Road.
And then we were posted in Pakistan. What year was that? 95 to 98, we're in Pakistan.
1995, 1998,
we're in Pakistan. And I'm a Boy Scout leader, I'm the deputy leader. And we're taking the Boy Scouts way up Hunza River, northern Pakistan. And we're whitewater rafting on the Hunza River. And we knew the Silk Road was way up there in the mountains of the banks of the Hunza River. So we took mountain climbing ropes with the Boy Scouts, thinking, well, maybe someday I'll walk on the Silk Road. So everybody knew my story. So we're whitewater rafting like this. And at a certain point, the Silk Road came down like maybe 3,000 feet above our heads. And we stopped, we pulled our whitewater, our rafts out, and we said, let's climb up and we'll do this. So we got the ropes out, we started climbing up, and the wind was like that, so strong, the wind coming up that valley. And then I said, stop, stop, stop. Somebody's going to get killed. I said, somebody's going to get killed. We're not going to do this. And so we stopped and we started coming down like this. And then this way, I looked like this, I looked that way. And here was a wash. You could tell, wash means lots of rocks and a lot of water had come down this area. And I don't know why, but for some reason I went 50 meters across this steep mountain, I went to that wash and started climbing up the wash. And then every time I came to a wall of rock, there'd be a hole through it. And I'd crawl through the hole and pop up on the other side. I kept going, kept going, kept going. All of a sudden, I'm standing on the Silk Road. I'm standing on the Silk Road. This is my dream from third grade. And way down there, you can see all the Boy Scouts, and I'm going like this to come up, and they all come up, and we're all standing on the Silk Road.
So want to know your observation regarding South Asian people?
Well, I never think about South Asian people. There is no such thing as South Asian people, because in Nepal you have all the different tribes, in India you have all the different ethnic groups. And even in Bangladesh, mostly Bengali, maybe 98-99% Bengali, and then a few tribals. So I don't generalize, because everybody's so different. Bangladeshi people are the best.
We are the best.
Yeah.
How? Why?
For many reasons. Bangladeshi, what I like most about Bangladeshi, I come from a place where people work hard. Bangladeshis work hard. Watch how Bangladeshis walk. When I'm sitting in traffic, I watch the sidewalk. It's moving. It's like a movie, a cinema. Free. Yeah. I don't pay any money. Watch. And watch how people walk. They walk like this. Everybody's going everywhere. Everybody's doing something.
Everybody's moving.
That. Yeah, moving. But with purpose. They're going somewhere. People are creative. They're very generous people. And entrepreneurial people, most entrepreneurial people. I love that trait. I come from a place where people have to be entrepreneurial. You live on a farm, something breaks, you gotta fix it. Who else is gonna fix it? There's nobody else there, it's me. You fix it, you learn to fix things, and you become very clever. And then, of course, Bangladeshis are the most tough people.
Tough people.
So those are traits. Those are Bangladeshi traits. I don't say South Asia. I say Bangladeshi. Those are Bangladeshi traits.
Ambassador,
I love those traits.
Before joining here as ambassador, you were a teacher for 1 year.
Oh, yes.
And you were, that was National Wire College. So your all dreams come true, finally.
Yeah, it's funny. I'm a very lucky person. Do you know, I've been in the Foreign Service 33 years. I've been ambassador twice, and I have other nice jobs. And in all those years, every time I would say to my mother, who's still alive, 93 years old, very sharp, and I would say to my mom, oh, mom, I'm going to be the ambassador to Angola. And she would say, oh, that's nice. And that was fine, end of it. And one day I called mom and said, mom, hey, guess what? I am going to be a teacher, a professor at the National War College. And then she said, finally, she said, finally, finally, you are doing what you always should have done. You are a teacher. She said, I always knew you had to be a teacher. And so in all these years, that was the thing she's most proud of. You ask my mother, what it...
Because her dream came true.
Her dream come true. She would say the best thing Danny ever did in his life was to be a teacher at the War College. That's what she said. She always wanted me. And so maybe now when I leave Bangladesh, I'll go back, I retire. I have to retire because we have an age limit.
Yeah.
And maybe I'll teach again because I really like to teach.
Yeah.
I really like to teach. I don't know why.
Ambassador, again, it's time to take a break.
Okay.
দর্শক, আবারও একটা ছোট্ট বিরতি নিচ্ছি, কথা বলবো অ্যাম্বাসেডর ড্যান মজিনার সঙ্গে। আমাদের সঙ্গে থাকবেন নিশ্চয়ই। দর্শক, আবারও ফিরলাম বিরতির পর, কথা বলছিলাম ড্যান মজিনার সঙ্গে। অ্যাম্বাসেডর, ইউ আর গোয়িং টু কমপ্লিট ইউর জব পিরিয়ড হেয়ার ইন ঢাকা অ্যান্ড ইউ আর গোয়িং টু রিটায়ার ফ্রম গভর্নমেন্ট সার্ভিস। So last 3 years, I recall your first press conference and you said you want to discover
yes.
Bangladesh. And congratulations, you have really done it. You are the one and only ambassador here in Dhaka who visited 64 districts. Many of Bangladeshis can't do that. So many people
How many of you visited?
I have visited. I have
all
visited, 64? Yeah,
oh
due to my profession.
Wonderful.
But you have visited and many people thought you know Bangladesh better than many Bangladeshis. So why you have done this? Why you have to visit 64 district here?
I had two reasons. And this is what I told the then president, the late president, Zia Rahman,
yeah.
when I gave him my credentials.
Didn't you?
And I said to the president, I said, I am going to visit all 64 districts. He said, that's a good thing to do. He said, why are you going to do that? And I said, two reasons. I want to take a little bit of America out to each district.
Okay.
And so people have some introduction to America. And then, and more importantly, I want to learn something. Because I'm America's ambassador to Bangladesh. Not only Dhaka, but all of Bangladesh. All of Bangladesh. So if I'm the ambassador of all of Bangladesh, then I want to go to all of Bangladesh.
Which place do you like most?
Oh, that's a very difficult question. I always say I like most the last place I've been or the place where the person who asked the question
yeah.
is from. So you're from Rajshahi, I like most Rajshahi. And the next guy is from Bogra, I like most Bogra.
Which thing of Bangladeshi people attract you most?
I like the friendliness.
Friendly attitude.
Not just superficial friendly, but connect friendly. People connect. Right now, I am connected with so many Bangladeshis.
You have many friends here.
But not friend in an empty sense, but in a real sense. People who know about me, I know about them. People care about me, I care about them. Because Bangladeshis, you know, in America we say, oh, Americans are friendly people. We say, we'll meet anybody halfway. Okay, that's nice, that's a good thing. Bangladeshi goes 90% of the way. 90%. I tell new people who come to the embassy, everybody has to come and say hello to me. I say, you know what? You're gonna love this place. If you go 10% of the way, Bangladeshis will go 90% of the way, and you'll connect, connect, connect. That's a wonderful trait, and it's sincere, it's genuine.
Ambassador, we have seen your picture with Riksha. We have seen your picture with Lungi. You love Bangladeshi food, we know sometimes.
No, I eat too much, look at me,
yeah.
fat.
Which food you like most here in Bangladesh?
Oh, easy question. Rice.
Rice with?
With nothing.
Only rice?
Rice, because the rice in Bangladesh is wonderful rice. We don't eat basmati rice. We eat kalajuri and chinigura, and we love that flavor of that rice. Yeah, there's nothing like Bangladeshi rice.
So being the ambassador, you have to, obviously in your career, you have to pass some tough time in your career for circumstances, for sometimes political situation. Can you please recall the most memorable moment of your career?
Well, in a crisis situation, it would have been when Rajiv Gandhi was assassinated in India.
Yeah.
That was a very tragic time.
At that time you were in India?
I was in India at that time. And I was the person responsible for helping to coordinate our response to that tragedy. That was very, very tragic time. I don't know if you remember, but he was killed in a bomb attack. And I think it was in Tamil Nadu. Yeah, that was very sad.
And what about your Bangladeshi period? I recall Rana Plaza tragedy at the time you were here.
If
and you have also seen some other political, social transformation here.
Well, the Rana Plaza was a horrible thing. And that hurt so much. That hurt so much. But my mom always said that the darkest, darkest clouds of life can have a silver lining. And Rana Plaza was a dark, dark cloud.
Ambassador, several times you have said about Bangladesh could be the next Asian tiger. And you are very much hopeful regarding Bangladeshi economy. Why?
Because the country is so rich. I learned so many things when I traveled all 64 districts. The country is so rich. The people are so industrious, hardworking, entrepreneurial. So yes, everything is here to be an Asian tiger. It should be the largest exporter of apparel in the world. It should be a huge global player for generic pharmaceuticals, for shoes, for finished leather goods. Oh, so many things, for frozen shrimp and bone china and IT, software development, semiconductor production. Oh, the list goes on and on. So many things, jute and silk and all this stuff. And all these things create an Asian tiger. Of course, there are obstacles, there are challenges. Yeah. Education is the biggest challenge.
My last question. You said you were here for strengthening, broaden the Bangladesh and US relationship. If I suggest you to evaluate yourself regarding this issue, how much you could?
Well, when I look at the partnership between Bangladesh and America, that partnership today is broader, is deeper, is stronger than ever before. In absolute terms, that's not just diplomatic speak. It is a powerful partnership. And I'm really proud to have added a little bit to it, and my successor will keep adding to it.
So if I told you, if you think Bangladesh after 10 years or 15 years, where you'd like to see Bangladesh?
Well, Bangladesh has to make a decision. Only Bangladesh can do this. Are you going to address the infrastructural challenges? Are you going to address the governance challenges? Corruption, red tape, lack of rule of law, threat of political instability, and then education, of course. Are you going to resolve those? All can be resolved. If with commitment and will, all can be resolved. Then Bangladesh is an Asian tiger. Then Bangladesh will be a middle income or higher country. Then Bangladesh will be like Malaysia and these other places. Very prosperous. People will live well. Because these are hardworking people.
Ambassador, want to finish about your dream. What's your dream now? You are now 65. You are almost, you have seen all the world. You have seen Bangladesh, you have seen America. So what dream, what is your that dream that not yet came true?
Oh, one always has dreams. And a part of my dream is to give back to the Foreign Service. For me, the Foreign Service, I've been a Foreign Service officer for 33 years, since 1981. It is not a job, it's a life. And now my dream is to give back. I want to give back. It has given me a beautiful, rich, exciting life. Now I want to give back. So when I go back to Washington, I have ideas, different ideas of how I can give back. And another thing I want to do is continue to work with the State Department and be like an acting ambassador. Let's say they have a vacancy someplace, then I'll go out for 3 months or 4 months and be the acting ambassador. So So I want to do that too. I'm also a grandfather. My granddaughter, as I said, is 1 year and 2 days old. Yeah. I want to spend time with her. And I want to help build my community. I'm a builder. I'm always building and building. And so I have to keep building.
Thank you, Ambassador. Thank you for your
valuable time. Thank you very much. I really enjoyed it. Very nicely done.
দর্শক, শেষ করতে হচ্ছে আজ আমরা অনেক অজানা গল্প জানলাম ঢাকায় আমেরিকার রাষ্ট্রদূত ড্যান মজীনার। আপনারা সবাই ভালো থাকবেন, পরবর্তী পর্বে নিশ্চয়ই দেখা হবে অন্য কোনো অতিথির সঙ্গে। সুস্থ থাকুন সবাই।